Turn around and touch three people and say that. I want to go where I've never been before. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I want to go where I've never been before. I want to go where I've never been before. I want to go where I've never been before. I want to go where I've never been before. I can't go unless you take me there. To another place. I can't go unless you take me there. To another place. I can't go unless you take me there. To another place. I need you to take me there. To another place. Never gonna be the same. Just turn around and tell somebody, I got to go to another place. Cannot stay in the same place. I gotta have another place. Too familiar with this place. I gotta have another place. Been here long enough. I need another place. Tell somebody, I've been saved a long time, but now I need another place in Him. If you believe that, somebody give God a praise right now. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Before you take your seats, I give honor to God. Before you take your seats, before you take your seats, I want us to stand to our feet. Turn the house up because I'm saying it three times. Want to give honor to Bishop and his absence tonight. Somebody put your hands together for Bishop Pullins. To Dr. Medina Pullins, somebody put your hands together for her tonight. And to all of the pastors and the elders tonight, somebody put your hands together for all of the ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And to all of my sweet mothers, it's always good to see all of y'all. Somebody give God praise for the mothers in Zion. You can do better than that. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. If you can bring that cord for me, please. I didn't know that my laptop was still on the plane, so the battery went out. But nevertheless, we're still going to be able to do what God is saying for us to do. I want you to get your Bibles. Another level. Thank you so much. Another dimension. Another place. The word of the Lord was so timely. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. The word of the Lord was so timely as to the subject matter. And I did not come all the way this way to bring about an excitement more than I did true elevation of change. The true elevation of change. Not something that is pretentious and something that is temporary. But we are embarking upon the eternal part of God now. We're embarking up on the mysteries of the word of the Lord. And I'm talking about mystery unto the manifestation of true power. The manifestation of true power. What do I mean by that? The manifestation of true power. Not the powers of exhortation, but the powers of being, the powers of existing. Just want you to just bear with me for a moment, because what God has downloaded to me during this time of fasting and praying, preparing for what the Lord has laid in my spirit that he's about to do. It is imperative that I release this word, because he downloaded this word to me. And this word changed my mind. Not just my life, but my mind. People say that things change their lives, but a lot of things can change your life, but very few things can change your mind. You know what I'm saying. You walked in here right now, and part of this building collapsed. Even if nobody got hurt, it would change your life, because it would give you a different perspective about the security of the ceiling of a facility. So things change your life. They change your life. But if you understand that all buildings are not like that, it didn't change your mind. Good Lord have mercy. It didn't change your mind, because you were walking to another building. So your mind didn't change. So then what we're really after in this hour is not so much that people saying something changed my life, but when my mind is fixed, when my thoughts are established, then many things can come, but I shall not be changed. I won't be moved. I had to look at a pattern first in Luke 4. And for the sake of time, I'm going to paraphrase. I listed some things, about eight things that I wanted to bring to your attention. I want to talk about Jesus. I want to talk about Jesus. I know we could talk about Paul and we could talk about Peter, but tonight I want to talk about Jesus. During his time of consecration, during his process of consecration, the Bible said in the fourth chapter that Jesus was preparing for one of the greatest moments of his life. And the Bible said he was full of the Holy Ghost. The Bible said he was led by the Spirit of God. I'm going somewhere with this, if you all just let me just take my time and build this right. Because this is a true transition. This is not a game. This is not a service. This is not just, we're talking about true elevation. Going up from where we are. In one service, we're going up from where we are. Never coming back to this place again. Just lean over and just tell your neighbor, I'm going up from this place, and I'm not coming back. Tell your neighbor, say, in about 30 minutes, I won't be back here no more. 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 He said he was led by the Spirit of God. And upon being led by the Spirit of God, because this word is going to take a lot of revelatory turns, so I need you to pay attention. I mean, he's saying to the ushers, unless it's bishop that come through that door, they have to sit in the back, because I can't let them break what I'm about to do. The leading of the Lord is presented in this passage as the possibility that it is of the leading of the Lord that you are led to be led by the devil. Jesus was led by the Spirit. But because he was filled with the Spirit and he was led by the Spirit, then the enemy was permitted to take him somewhere. Because what he was going to do was experience the mindset of the enemy, but he was not going to succumb to the enemy. Somebody said that was good. So a lot of times you're encountering things and you're experiencing things and you're going through things and you're saying, I know that I'm saved. I know what I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And why is the enemy doing this? Or why is the enemy doing that? But you have to understand that some things that the enemy is allowed to test you in is because you are filled. It's because you are led. I just said something right there. And so what God has to do now, he has to come and test the leading. He has to find out whether or not your leading is of your, is of your emotions, or are you settled in that thing? Are you established in the leading of the Lord? Because if I'm filled with the Spirit, then I can be tested by the Spirit. The Bible said that I have the permission to try every spirit to see if that spirit be of the Spirit of God. But if I'm filled with the Spirit and I run from every spirit, then I have no relationship and I have no knowledge of a spirit, because I did not allow myself to try that spirit. So then I become a naive Christian because I know the Lord, but I don't know the spirit realm. And if I don't know the spirit realm, then I don't know that I'm being deceived by a familiar spirit that knows how to immolate itself to be of God. Because the enemy came from God. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. He was one with God. Everything in the heavens was one with God. And so when you're one with God, you do possess the nature of the powers. Now your powers are being led by God, because you're not the devil that can do anything you want to do. You are still the devil that are being used by God. And the reason why God uses you is for the perfecting of the saints. To the people that think that the devil is just running rapid and he can do whatever he wants to do, that's not the truth. He's on assignments. That's not the truth. I'm going somewhere with this. So here Jesus is. He was led by the Spirit. He was on a 40-day fast. Now watch this. I'm getting it. The enemy said, turn this bread, this stone into a bread. Just do some tricks for me. Prove your power. And then that's when Jesus answered him and said, I know it's familiar to you, but listen to this. Man should not live by bread alone. The Amplified Bible said, man cannot live by bread alone. Man cannot be sustained. The Amplified Bible said, sustained In other words, if I eat bread alone, I cannot be sustained, meaning I cannot be steady, I cannot be perpetual, I cannot be unabating, I cannot be relentless, I cannot be unbroken, I cannot be unceasing, I cannot be around the clock, never ending, and I cannot be prolonged. So if I just eat bread alone, I have none of these attributes. But if I, watch this, but if I have the word of God, then I can be prolonged, I can be perpetual, I can be unabated, I can be relentless, I can be unbroken, I'm not hearing y'all, and I can be this around the clock, and I can be this and it never ends. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? So then the word of the Lord that comes out of the mouth of God is my sustaining power. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not just talking about scripture. I'm not talking about scripture. I'm talking about the word of God. Watch this. The word of God cannot do the act of God unless somebody is in the spirit realm that know how to download it in your belly. Everybody can preach the Bible. I'm not talking about preaching the Bible. I'm talking about preaching the word of God unto the spirit of God, and the individual as life. Okay, so how does that happen? So how does that happen? How is it that the word of God is being preached to the person that is preaching? There is a download. So after he's tested by bread, by stones, to see if whether or not Jesus was going to succumb to, watch this, to the manifestation of works instead of stability in the will of God. See, people can do a lot of works, mother. People can do a lot of calisthenics, but they're not stable in God. And see, then when you're led by the Spirit, because some of y'all say, well, when is all this going to be over with, Lord? Because when you're led by the Spirit of God and you're full of the Spirit of God and you refuse to allow the enemy to make you succumb to craziness because you want to walk in the stability of God, then the enemy don't stop there. Watch this. The next thing he do is he take you to a higher place. In other words, now it's time to go to a higher test. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. So then what is all of this about? What is it all about? It's about this. The devil wasn't after the bread. He wasn't after the bread. He wasn't after the antics. The enemy will cause you to do a lot of things that he's not even after. He'll cause you to operate in a lot of stuff that he's not even after. He's not even interested in that. What he does is he baits us with antics, because what he's trying to get is your leading. He wants your leading. He wants your leading. Because the Bible said, those that are led by God, those that are led by the Spirit. And so if the enemy can get you to start doing other things other than being led by God. See, had Jesus took the stone and turned it into bread, he would have lost his leading. Because now the enemy is leading him. God is not leading him. The devil is leading him. I'm not hearing y'all. Tell somebody he after your leading. He's after your leading. He don't want you to be led by God. So he'll introduce you to things. Watch this. And he will introduce you to things that are, wait a minute, that are godly things, but not the timing of God. So his trick is, I do what is godly, but I miss the timing of it. Because if I miss the timing of it, now I'm in another realm. So God is over here talking, And I done got moved over here. And so whatever God is saying over there, I can't hear him. Because once I walk away from God's leading and into the leading of the enemy, I'm on another highway. And so the voice of the Lord is at a distance from me. Because the reason why the enemy wants to get me on another highway is because he knows that on another highway, if I cannot hear from God, then I cannot keep going under the pressure of what I am dealing with. So his job is to get me as far away from God as he possibly can by letting me do godly things, but it's not the will of God for my life for that timing. I'm preaching already.
Watch this.
Because what he is after, he was only after one thing in all of that testing that he did. He was after Jesus' worship. He didn't want his bread. He didn't want none of that. He said, if you're going up here and cast yourself down and throw yourself down, he said, you know what? The angels will catch you lest your feet dash again. He was leading Jesus to do all these different things. But the bottom line of it is he didn't want any of that. All he wanted was his worship. He wanted his worship because he recognized then that there's something that is in worship that brings about a connection and an authority. It's something about worship that causes men to be able to hear God in a way that they've never heard God before. And so what he's saying is, if I can get you to worship me, if I can get you to worship me, then watch this. If I can get you to worship me, then Jesus, you will be able to hear my desire clearer. Whatever you worship, you can hear clearer. I'm not getting nobody to say nothing right there.
I said, whatever you worship, you can hear clearer.
I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Whatever you worship, you can hear clearer. When you worship God, the reason why you can hear God clearer is because something about your emotions and your flesh and your mind begin to paralyze itself. I'm not hearing y'all. It begin to lose all activity and all motion and all thought and all will and all desire. So then it brings me to where I'm trying to go. When you recognize that it is the devil. When you recognize that it is him. Watch this. My God. When you recognize that it is of the enemy. Watch this. When I know that what I'm dealing with is the enemy, then what do I do? Watch this. He says something here that struck me. When you are in the divine worship of God, you are in the divine knowledge of God, you are in the divine perception of God. When you are in God like that, you are able to decipher what is Satan and what is God. And you do not confuse people. You do not confuse people with a spirit. Because y'all are hearing me. Because not only did Jesus say, "Get behind me, Satan," but the next time when he walked up and Peter said to him, "I don't want them to come and get you," he didn't look at Peter and say, "Peter, don't say that." He saw a spirit in him and he said, "Satan, get behind me." I'm going somewhere with this. So then what is it that causes the people of God to experience what we call warfare? I really have to help somebody with this one. What is warfare? Warfare is not what anybody does to you from the outside in.
Warfare is not anything that the devil does to you. Jesus, in this experience right here, he was not in warfare. Somebody said, I beg the difference. He was not in warfare, people of God. He was not in warfare. He was not in warfare. He was being tested by the works of the enemy. Watch this. To cause the will of God to become secure in him because of what he was going to be facing. He didn't need to shake in his will. I ain't trying to make you shout. I'm not trying to make you. I'm trying to tell you what changed my life. What changed my mind. He wasn't trying to do that. Because watch this. Now here it is. That wasn't his warfare. That wasn't his warfare. Because he never planned in any kind of way to jump off of a high place. He wasn't suicidal. He never planned in any kind of way to operate in tricks because he's led by his father. He never planned to deny God in any kind of way. He never planned to ever worship the devil. Why should I worship something that my mouth helped create? I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. What gonna make me bow down to you when my mouth made you? I'm the one that created you. What do I look like worshiping something that I created? I cannot worship you because you're not a power. You're not a power. You are a being. Lord have mercy. You know, people walk around and say, well, you know what? So-and-so is powerful. There's a difference of being powerful and being a being. Powerful means my source of power do not come from an individual. I'm not hearing y'all. When I'm just a being in ministry, it means then that anything that God uses me to do, I got to get it from somebody else. I'm not hearing y'all. But when you are powerful, your source comes from God. It comes from a place that is not of this earth realm. Oh my God. He said, I cannot worship you because you're not a power. Satan, you are speaking to me with my breath. How can I worship you when you are talking to me with my breath? Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying. How can I worship you when everything that you're looking at, the legs that you use to take me up to the high place, the eyes that you got to even see out over the world, those are my eyes. As a matter of fact, it's my world. How you gonna give me something that already belongs to me? See, that's a revelation by itself. That's a revelation by itself. Because how can the devil keep telling you what he gonna do to you when the power that lives in you is the breath that he needs to even talk? How you gonna attack me? You're not a power. You're not a power. I'm not hearing y'all. The Bible said he gave him the authority. The power you got, God gave it to you. And that's why the Bible said that when Jesus went to the cross, the Bible said he stripped him of his power and made an open show out of him. So now, how can the enemy overtake a believer when what's in the believer have deemed him powerless?
Okay, I'm not gonna get nobody. I can't get nobody to talk to me right now. Because see, we under false theory. We under false theory that we're dealing with a devil that's out of control, and we're dealing with a devil that's this and a devil that's that and a devil that's it. But see, Jesus said that the prince of this world coming, but he finds none of him in me. So then the real warfare for the believer comes in when there is something that is left in you that belongs to the enemy. When it's all y'all, I'm not hearing nobody.
Wait. Sit down.
Cause I got to do this. I'm all the way on 10. I'm going all the way back down because I got to get the sound right. I'm going all the way back down to nothing. Take me all the way back down to nothing. Take everything off. Turn it all off. Now I'm gonna turn it on. Cause I know the enemy don't want you to hear this. He don't want you to hear this. There you go. Right here. Put a little reverb on it. There you go. He don't want you to hear this. He don't want you to get this one. Mm-mm. He don't want you to have this one. So here Jesus go. He has tested me. He has come to me and tried to test the part of me that I have been given permission to abide in for the duration of the completion of an assignment. So he's not testing the Christ. He's testing Jesus. Because he was human and divine. He's not testing no divine part. He trying to see if Jesus done jumped in his natural mind. You don't hear what I'm saying to you. If Jesus done forgot that he's under the auspices of his Father, he's trying to test him to see if while you on this earth realm, have you lost your connection? And now are you enthroned by who you are? Because now you can brag that I'm human and divine. So watch this. So because I'm human and divine, now I'm walking the earth realm, and I have to train myself how to vacillate between two worlds. Man of God, I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. I gotta teach myself. See, because, let me show you this. Let me show you what I'm talking about. The Bible said he was on his way. He was on his way into a city to minister. And the Bible said he looked up and saw afar off, and he saw a fig tree. And when he got to the fig tree, the Bible said that it wasn't even the season of the fig tree to bear fruit. So that's like in Georgia, during the summertime, it's peach season. So during the fall and winter months, you know, strawberries and everything is, it kind of go out of season. So they have to, if you're going to get strawberries, you got to go to another city that the climate is always warmer if you're going to get strawberries. But if you're in Chicago and you want some strawberries, you know that strawberries is out of season. So when by the time Jesus, Dr. Medina got to the fig tree, the Bible said it was out of season. So then I'm asking the Lord, well, why is Jesus mad? Because, you know, it ain't the season. You know, you walk up on a fig tree and you want something to eat, but it ain't no season. It's not the season. So should he really be angry? Should he really be upset? Should he be upset to the point that he would curse the fig tree and say, you're not going to have nothing else to live on you ever again. You're going to just be dried up. Then, okay, is it that bad that you would curse the fig tree because it's not even the fig tree's season to bear fruit? And I questioned the Lord, and for weeks I kept asking God, what does this mean? And God began to say to me, he said, what I'm trying to help you to understand is that the fig tree is not a fig tree because somebody planted a seed. The fig
tree became a fig tree because Jesus spoke it into existence. So how is it that the man that speaks you into existence, when you get to that person, you can't deliver fruit no matter what season it is? Because when he spoke the world into existence, it wasn't the world season. Everything in this world is created, and it wasn't its season. He didn't look out over the darkness and say, I think it's around about the season to make a earth. And then I think it's around about the season to make some trees. He just started speaking stuff into existence. So then he said, when I show up and I desire something out of you. See, that's when God changed my life. Because here people tell you around, people will tell you all the time, when you go through a hard time, it ain't your season. And you got to wait for that. No, that ain't what the scripture said. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Because when I'm walking with the authority of Jesus Christ in me, the Bible said, no, I give you power. The Bible said, you are not to pay attention for the seasons, for the times is in the hands of the Lord. Which means anybody that learned how to trust God, it is always your season. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. You don't have to wait for the weather to change. You don't have to wait for people to change their mind about you. You are always in the season of the Lord. Who am I talking to right now? Can't get nobody to talk to me. First of all, you done missed so much stuff listening to that kind of foolishness. And God said, when you recognize that I am the season changer and that the season changer is in you, which means you can decree a thing. The Bible said, when you decide it, then I will do it for you. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Can't get nobody to say nothing right there. Can't get nobody to say nothing right there. Can't get nobody to talk to me right there. Can't get nobody. Because see, some of y'all looking at me, but what I'm trying to say is I just said something that was powerful. In other words, whatever it is you're dealing with, you can shift yourself out of that thing into a whole other dimension right now. I don't know what you're waiting on. I said, I don't know what you're waiting on. Wait a minute. So he said, you don't tell me it ain't your season. Told the fig tree, who you talking to? You don't tell me you ain't got no fruit. Yeah, because when I spoke you into existence, fruit was in you. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. No. Ain't nobody saying nothing. Ain't nobody saying. He said, when I spoke you into existence, I created you with my mouth with fruit in you. What do you mean you can't produce nothing? I just said something to somebody right there. What do you mean you can't get it done? What do you mean you don't know whether or not it's going to happen or not? He said, when I called you out of darkness and into the marvelous light, I birthed you into the kingdom with fruit in you. What are you talking about? And God has said, where is my fruit? There's a fruit I put in you. Can't get nobody saying that. I said, where's the fruit I put in you? Where is the stuff that I created you with? I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I said, where is the stuff that I created you with? Where is it? Well, they said I can. Who said? Well, what happened was, what happened? Wait. I don't know, God. Why don't you know? Why don't you know? What is it that you don't know? I'm going to help us right now. What is it that you don't know? What is it that you're battling with that you don't know? So then here comes the spiritual warfare.
And the spiritual warfare is not from without. So then what is this warfare that I'm dealing with? What is this warfare that I'm dealing with? So here Jesus now, he has gone into the earth realm. Listen to this. He goes on his consecration. He is tempted and tested. But it wasn't even no, you know, you didn't see him crying and being all bent out of shape. Every translation I read, it reads more like, put your camera phone down, because I don't want your camera to get something your spirit missed. This is heavy. He's tempted and he's tested. But my reading and my discernment is more of a frustration and aggravation more than an overthrowing. I mean, I don't sense that Jesus is about to just give in or okay. It was like, what now? All right, okay, take me up here. Now what? Now, what now? No, I'm not going to do that. You shouldn't tempt the Lord thy God. Now what? No, I'm not going to throw myself down. What? Man should not live by bread alone, but I can't be bothered with you right now. So then, how does he get to power? Self-sufficient, sustaining power. Well, the power that he walks in, it does not depend upon any source in the earth realm. When God cuts you loose from the source in the earth realm, that's a victory that you can't even imagine. I can't get nobody to talk to me right there. When God does something in your spirit where you know now that everything that I'm about to do ain't got nothing to do with who think they're going to give me permission to do it, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. See, the reason why Jesus was able to walk the earth the way he did, because he got his orders from heaven. The reason why he was able to do the things that he did, because nothing around him depended upon helping him to do that. Are you hearing me? He walked isolated from the world. As a matter of fact, half the time they didn't even know what he was going to do. So then if he's going to experience warfare, then we got to decide what is warfare.
Okay.
Warfare cannot be in B if we are the believers and we are the soul, the believers of the Holy Ghost. Uh-huh. Then warfare, true warfare, cannot be what people do to us. It cannot be, people of God. We experiencing so much warfare. We experiencing so much warfare. So here Jesus is. He says, it wasn't even warfare when he said, one of y'all is the devil and one of y'all gonna betray me. Uh-huh. I want you to see this. I want you to see how he handled that. He didn't handle that like, oh, I'm just going through spiritual warfare. Y'all just pray for me. He said, one of y'all is the devil. Now watch this. He said, one of y'all is Satan. One of y'all going to betray me. And people misquote that and they say that the disciples were saying, is it I, Lord? God said, go back and read that. Judas said, is it not I? And Jesus said, you have spoken well, because no, if you are the person that is going to bring me down, then I cannot be the Lord. I'm not hearing you. It is not you, but it is Satan. You have answered well. It is not you. You are just the instrument that God is going to use to get me to the glory. I'm not hearing y'all.
I'm not hearing y'all. The devil needed a body because he could not. Are you hearing me? He could not take me in the warfare on the mountaintop. He couldn't do it with the stone. He couldn't do it by making me lay down. So in order for me to get this power, I got to die out of this glorious experience that I'm having in the earth realm. I just said something so powerful right there. Something, man of God, gotta get me out of this wonderful experience that I'm having. See, that's what's wrong with the body of Christ. We're so busy having a wonderful experience that we can't go on the power. Lord have mercy. We're so busy being stuck in all of what we're accomplishing. We can't go on the power. He said, but something gotta help me out of this wonderful thing that I'm. Because the wonderful thing is my destruction. Y'all. The wonderful thing is about to destroy my great thing. Now, I'm not hearing y'all. Healing the sick and raising the dead and casting out devils and being called a wonder and crowds following me everywhere I go and crowds being having to put me in a boat because there's so many people following me. Me taking two fish and five loaves of bread and feeding 5,000. This stuff is about to be the destruction of my power. I gotta get out of this. I gotta get out of this glory. I gotta. Lord, I didn't get nobody to say nothing right there. I didn't get nobody to say nothing right there. I ain't getting nobody to say nothing. Because the hardest thing for us to do is to be willing to let go of what we think is great. Because everybody that's being hindered into going into what the Lord has for you and going into that power, you're not having a devilish experience. You have an experience where God is blessing you and stuff is going good and doors are opening up and the Lord is making ways out of no way. But God said, it is that lamb right there. Jesus said, I'm saying something right here. I'm saying something right here, son. Jesus said, he gets in the garden. We better stop playing. He gets in the garden and he says, okay, God, says to the disciples, come on. We're going to prayer. And then the Bible said, and this right here helped me, said Jesus got depressed. And people make me sick. Yeah, you lift up your head. No, Jesus got depressed. He got discouraged. And he said, I'm heavy in my heart. Because in order for me to do the will of the Father, I got to leave my friends. My God. I'm not here. They not going to be saying, there go Jesus no more. They're going to forget all about that I raised the dead and I cast out devils. They're not going to remember none of that. And I'm going to have to give up that reputation. I'm going to have to let that fame go. I might have to let the wonderfulness about my name go to the dirt. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. Can't get nobody. So then, what is his warfare? And he gets in prayer and he starts to pray. Now watch this. And he says, the Bible said, and he prayed until sweat poured out of his pores. As of like, mother, drops of blood. So then, sis, he began to pray.
people just stop lying. I'm an intercessor. God called me to be an intercessor, and the Lord told me that he want me to pray it. And I'm over the intercessory prayer team. No, Jesus began to pray until his forehead began to reveal the secret of his thorns. He began to pray until what he was going to have to do began to manifest itself in his body while he was praying. Now, somebody didn't just get what I just said. Somebody, there was going to be a crown of thorns on his head. He began to pray until the will of the Father began to show up in his body, even before he went to the cross. I'm not hearing y'all. No, you're not you are not in intercession until what you are praying about, if that thing begin to take you over. You're not praying for nobody that's got cancer until the night that you throw up like you sick to your stomach. Who am I talking to? I'm not getting nobody to talk back to me. Jesus began to pray until the cross began to happen in his intercession before he got to the cross.
The whole room is quiet.
He began to pray until crucifixion began to seep through his skin. And then God knew, watch this, that it was time. Because how did the Lord know that it was time? God changed my mind in this. How did the Lord know that it was time? Because the warfare of the believer is not what people do to you on the outside. The warfare of the believer is the decision that you have to make.
I can't get nobody. Jesus wasn't warned with no devil swarming around him. Jesus wasn't warned with nobody talking about him. Jesus wasn't warned with nobody lying on him. Jesus wasn't warned with nobody spitting on him. Watch this. His warfare was, I gotta make a decision. My God. His warfare was, in my spirit, I gotta decide which one of us is gonna stay alive and which one of us is gonna die. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Who am I talking to? His decision. That's why the devil get a foothold in your life, because somebody have not made a decision.
I can't get nobody to talk to me. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing.
Okay, see, the reason why what the devil does on the outside affects you is because your decision on the inside is not sealed.
Bishop, can I just get somebody to help me tonight? Can I just get one person to help me? Because, see, I know what I'm talking about. Because when your mind is made up that you're going all the way with God, stuff starts happening all around you. And people be looking at you like, you ain't upset. You like, I ain't studying that. I ain't got time to address that. Why do you get to that point? You come to a point where you are able to ignore the works of the devil on the outside, because my inside have already made a decision. Who am I talking to?
Oh, my God. I've already decided, but I reckon that the shepherd of this present time is not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us.
I have already decided on the ultimate gateway of suffering. I have already decided that I'm going to die. So what is more aggressive than death? I'm going to say that one more time. So he says, Father, if it be your will, listen, let this cup pass from me.
But nevertheless, not,
people keep missing it. Nevertheless, not my will, which means the human side of him had one. He wouldn't have had a reason to tell God not mine if he didn't have one. Because I really don't want to die. I really don't want to leave. I know I got to do your will, but nevertheless, he could have said, okay, God. He could have said, if it be your will, Lord, let this cup pass from me. But all right. He said, nevertheless. And God said to me, Juanita Bynum, nevertheless is a powerful thing. I said, God, what are you saying? He said, he could have said, all right, to me. He could have said, Lord, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. And he said, but then, if you want to, God, we're going to do that. He said, nevertheless. Nevertheless, not only means in spite of all of that, in spite of all of what I'm going to encounter, but he said, look up the root word never. And the root word never says, not in the past, not in the future, for no occasion, for no reason. In other words, no matter what's going on, in my spirit, not in my past, not in my future, and for no occasion and no reason will I do my own will. In other words, I've already decided.
Wait a minute. Wait. If it be your will, let this cup pass from me. It's Jesus talking. Nevertheless, is the Christ speaking up for him.
I'm going to say that one more time. If it be your will, let this cup pass from me. And then all of a sudden, your spirit man speak up for you and say, but nevertheless.
Okay. Wait a minute. Nevertheless, not my will. So then the problem then that the Lord said to me is that we are stuck in the wrong will. Can I just please help us one time? See, there is three forms of will. There is the first form that I'm going to just brush into tonight, okay. Is the model, it's called in the dictionary, the model verb. Model means fashion. Model means design. Model means the way something is constructed. The first wheel of the model, meaning fashion, meaning that the people walk around looking like they in the wheel. They walk around dressing like they, I'm not hearing nobody talking to me. It's a fashion and a form. You know, it's when people just cry out to God, oh God, your will. But see, it's a fashion. It's a fashion. And so how do I know it's a fashion? Because soon as something else comes along that the devil wants you to do, you change clothes. See, when you come to church on Sunday, you dress like you say. Friday night, you a pole dancer because it's a fashion. It's not a real will, because a model verb, the model verb is a fashion, and the dictionary said it is a fashion that has form but no substance. That's what the dictionary said. That wasn't the Bible. That's what the dictionary said. It said it has no substance in it. In other words, the person is not grounded in anything. They just train themselves how to look like they're in the will, how to shout like they're in the will, how to speak in tongues like they're in the will, but they have no substance to their life. Now, how is it that they have no substance? Because this will is called a model verb. And the, watch this, and the verb of the word will is associated with speech.
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute, because I gotta read this to you right quick. This ain't the will. This ain't that will. This will right here, son, is associated with speech. This will is expressing, listen how many times I say this, expressing the future tense, expressing a strong intention, expressing an inevitable event, expressing a request, expressing desire, expressing facts about ability and capacity, expressing habitual behavior, expressing probability or expectations about something. So when you are in the model will, you're the person that talk too much. You always talking about what you want to do for God. When you are, I'm not hearing about, when you're in the model will, you know how to talk a good talk. You always, listen, people that's in the model will, they said they always requesting something. You always begging for something. You always got something to say. You always talking about the ability of God. You always talking about the capacity of God. You just can't be what God desires you to be. You just only have the power to talk about it.
I can't get no amen. So the church is having church off of a bunch of people that's always talking about how good God is, and talking about how wonderful he is, and talking about what we want to do for God, and talking about how we love him. But when it's time to love him, because your love for him is not going to be conducive for the right condition, your love for God cannot be proven to God until you are faced with something else that you want to love.
See, there was no proof of love until you faced with something else you want to love. There's no proof of faith until you face with something else you want to believe. Wait a minute. Your trust in God can never be tested until another source is put there for you to decide to trust in. Okay, I ain't getting nobody to talk to me. Everybody just done went home. I ain't getting nobody to talk to me. You don't. You can't hold up by shaking. Thank you, Jesus. You can't believe God. You can't believe God until the devil tried to give you something else to believe. I'm not hearing you. And so the reason why your belief system receives power is because you deny what you could have believed. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. And you chose to keep on believing God. Who am I talking to? That's the reason why you got to shout in here. And some of y'all will sit here with your legs locked like God ain't even in the building. But the reason why the people in here that you see jumping up and acting like they're crazy and praising God is because when they could have trust something else, when they could have believed something else, when they could have loved something else, they chose. Touch your neighbor and say, I could have believed something else. Touch your neighbor and say, I could have believed something else, but I chose to believe God. And that's why I'm still praising him. That's why I got a praise in my spirit. Hey, my shout it. Man of God. Hey, da 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 da, my shout it.
Hey, da da da, boko shout it. He come down to the boko shout it. Oh, come on, somebody, let's go help somebody. Because when it look like it ain't going to happen, when it look like God ain't going to do it, when it look like it ain't going to work out, the devil's job is to give you something else to believe. But your job is to be steadfast and unmovable and always abounding in the works of the Lord. Y'all sit down, let me make this point. You're supposed to be given. Wait a minute. Somebody
Somebody said in here, my faith is just property. I just need God to just help me with some, help me with my faith. This is what you don't know. Another opinion is only presented to people that already have one. See, the reason why the devil trying to present doubt, because you already got faith. I'm not hearing y'all. He wouldn't be trying to present nothing to you if he was empty. The reason why he trying to give you fear is because you got courage. The reason why he trying to, I'm not hearing y'all. The reason why he trying to convince you that you ain't got no power is because you got power. He trying to give you an alternative. Tell somebody I already got it. Tell somebody I already got it. Tell somebody the devil is in my face because of what I already got. The devil is trying to present me with something else because he don't like the fact that I already got a decision. I'm not hearing y'all. I already got power. I already got faith.
I'm gonna help you. I'm gonna help you. Now, I don't want to get in trouble with God because I got to finish this lesson. But I'm going to say this, and y'all got to promise me y'all going to be good. But see, the bottom line, my God from Zion, my God from Zion, my God from Zion. See, because everybody, can I borrow your pens?
See, he said, what's going on?
He said, the disciples said, why couldn't we cast these devils out? And he said, oh ye of little faith. And he was mad at them. He was mad at them because their faith was small. Y'all ain't saying that. So I was in question because I said, Lord, I need to believe you for, and he said to me, do not present to me false faith. And I said, but God, I believe you. And literally he said these words to me. He said, you're doing too much. I said, well, I'm doing too much. I said, I'm believing you with all my heart, with all my mind. He said, you're doing too much. He said, you're exhausting yourself in a false faith. He said, I said. Now, everybody in here, take a pen. Get an ink pen right quick. Hurry up. Hurry up. Now, take that ink pen. Hurry up. Borrow one from your neighbor, because it's going to be quick. I want everybody in here to take ink pen, and I want you to put a dot on your finger with your ink pen. Hurry up. Hurry up. Hurry up. You got to do it quick. You got to do it quick and pass the ink pen. When you get it on your finger, hold it up. Hold it up. Hold it up. Hold it up. He said to me, that you got it on your finger. Somebody, hold your finger up. I need to see some fingers up in this place. I need to see some fingers up in this place. You got your finger up? Okay, now turn around and look at your finger. He said, that's all the faith I told you to have. He said, I said, if you would have the faith the size of a grain of a mustard seed, you could speak to a mountain, and the mountain got to get out of your way. He said, y'all trying to have a whole lot of faith. He said, and the reason why I was mad at the disciples, because they didn't even have that much. That's all I told you to have. That's all I told you to have. I'm not giving y'all. And this is what the devil is mad about. He's mad because God did not require us to have all this faith. He's mad because God gave us a God that can shift his whole world. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Y'all better open up your mouth right now. Wait a minute. Then he said, son, he said, look this up. He said, look up mustard seed. So I looked up mustard seed and it said, this seed, Bishop, is 3 millimeters big. It's about the biggest that dot, 3 millimeters. Then it said, now here's a miracle. He said, this seed is the smallest seed in the world. Kept reading. He said, scroll down into the biological history of it. So they said, if you took a cube, which is about 2 inches wide, and stretched it out 7 miles, and poured mustard seeds in it, and you chose one mustard seed every 100 years, the replenishing of the mustard seed would replenish itself to be 969 billion years old. So God said, I compared your faith to a seed that can outlive the world. Now see, y'all. No, you didn't hear that. You don't want to shout at my heart. You didn't hear that. You did not hear what I just said. That dot with a mustard seed faith will outlive this world. Are you kidding me? It'll keep producing itself when the world is gone. It will keep producing itself 900 and something billion years later. Who am I talking? Now I understand what he said. And you shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Wait a minute. Why does God say that? Why does he say that? Because a mustard seed is the only seed in the history of the world. It's an herb. And it's supposed to grow no more than 12 inches high. It is the only herb that is planted as an herb but grow like a tree. Y'all. Can't get nobody to say nothing right there. Okay, in other words, whatever you believe in God for, if you plant that thing in your spirit, that thing will start growing like a tree. Who am I talking to? What you mean all you got is a little bit of faith. You got a mustard seed, which means when you put that in your spirit, I'm not hearing. You better tell your neighbor, move over. I think I feel something growing. I think I feel something sprouting out of me. What you talking about? I think I feel some leaves coming up. I think I feel some branches coming up. Who am I talking to? There is no way that you can believe God like a mustard seed, and what you get is not the benefits of a tree. Just tell somebody, a tree is growing in me. Y'all didn't even say that like you meant that. Tell somebody, say, everything that I've been believing God for, a tree is growing in me. Somebody better give God a praise right there.
Wait a minute. I gotta finish with this. I gotta close. I gotta close.
I can't get nobody to talk to me because this thing is messing with your psychology, and I know it. It's messing with your psychology because, Lord, I'm not shaking. He said that's the reason why the people of God don't have a whole lot of stuff that I done promised them, because they try to trust me with a false faith when I told them, go back to mustard seed. I'm not giving y'all. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Tomorrow night, I'm going to bring some mustard seed. You're going to walk up on this altar and take one, and you're going to swallow it, and I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. It's going to be on then. Because the devil is a liar. He's trying to deceive the people of God when the Bible says all we need is a faith as a size.
So what does the enemy do?
He presents us. He presents us with a false faith that is a fashion that has no power in it, because he already knows that we possess a faith that works. He keeps trying to present you with some more faith. I can't get nobody talking. I can't get nobody to talk to me. Y'all ain't saying nothing in this building. He keeps trying to give you some more faith so that your mind can ignore the true faith. No, you. When God gave me this revelation, when I say everything that was held up broke open in 30 days. It's like stuff started breaking open. I'm like, what in the world? I said, God, what in the world? What in the world? And every time I get ready to do something, he said, before you do it, put a dot on your finger and tell yourself, I got this much. Let me go on in this place and fill out this application, because I got this much. Yeah, let me go on in here and get this new car. Yep. I got this much. Let me go on in the plaque of this house. I ain't got no money down. I don't know where it's coming from, but what I got this much. I'm going with this much. Y'all don't hear me. People start getting miracles like left and right. I'm not here. Every door that was shut, God, you open it. I'm not here. Nobody talk to me. Television stations started calling it. Why? Because I released the false faith and went back and got my dime. It's right here. See, the mystery to what I'm saying is that the emotions are immediately encouraged and receive confidence because it is looking at something that is so minute that the mind now has the ability to tell the emotions, we got this much. Now, y'all. Did somebody just get what I said? So now I walk with a different confidence in God. Who am I talking to? You walking out of this building tonight in a different confidence in God, because you're going to say, I got this much. You don't hear what I'm saying to y'all. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Now I know why the Bible said, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Why? Because I didn't tell you to have all of that. I told you to have this. And so if you got less than this, then God is offended. He is offended. Yeah. I can't get nobody to really just go with me all the way on this. But it was like I jumped off the Grand Canyon. Because I believe that somebody will catch me. People start calling me up and saying, prophets, I want you to pray for me. I said, what I want you to do is put a dot on your finger. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I want you to put a dot on your finger, because that dot on your finger, if you open up your mouth and speak it, a mountain will get up and you can tell it where to go. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. If you just talk to your finger, y'all ain't hearing me. Y'all ain't hearing me. You can tell finances where to go. I'm not hearing y'all. Who am I talking to? No, you don't need no prayer. You need a dot. Can't get nobody to say nothing like that. You don't need no prayer partner. You need a dot. You need to carry an ink pen. That's what your problem is. You don't need nobody to touch and agree with you. You need to carry an ink pen. No, I... I can't. I'm trying to get somebody to practice. I'm trying to get somebody to practice. Because you're looking at the situation. I'm not hearing y'all. You're looking at the circumstance. I came in here to preach to somebody. You're looking at the condition. You're looking at the situation. You need to run some interference with a finger. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. You need to put your finger in front of that house. You need to put your finger in front of your college education. You need to put your finger in front of that loan. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing. You're looking at the wrong thing.
He didn't say, look at the mountain. He didn't say, look at the mortgage. He didn't say, look at the car notes. I don't need to look at the piano. I need to look at my finger. I don't need to look at the situation. I need to keep my eyes on this finger. And if I'm going to move my finger, I'm going to move my finger to speak to it. I'm not hearing nobody. Speak to it. Yeah, did y'all see what I did? You ain't seeing what I'm doing. You ain't seeing what I'm doing. My eyes is open when I'm looking at my finger. When I'm speaking to the situation, I close my eyes because I don't need to see you because you're not going to be there no way. So I'm not looking for nothing. I'm going to look at my finger and then I'm going to pull my finger away and shut my eyes and speak to the situation. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Yes, you got. Because why? Why must I speak to it? Because now I must speak with what I just saw in the spirit of my mind. Who am I talking to? I can't speak to what it is right now. I gotta speak to what God just spoke in my spirit.
Wait,
I'm gonna close with this. I'm closing with this. I'm closing with this. Wait a minute. Here it is, y'all. Here it is. This thing is powerful. This is miraculously powerful. There's so many miracles in this thing. He said, look up the word speak. So I looked up speak, and it says in the association, man of God, to speaking, you cannot declare you personally. You can see somebody's mouth moving, but you personally do not possess the authority to say somebody is speaking unless you can hear them. If they are speaking and you can't hear them, they are mouthing to you. They are speaking to him because you can't hear. So the language to you is mouthing. This is getting ready to change your thinking. So he said then, look up the connection, Dr. Medina, to when a person is being spoken to. I said the connection, God, then is hearing. He said, well, okay. So then now look up the word hear. So I looked it up in a dictionary and it said, and to hear a sound of phonics. He said, keep reading. So I started digging and digging and digging. Finally, I landed on it. It says, when a person, medical science have proven that when a person is spoken to and they just don't hear phonically, tones, vowels, nouns, they don't hear, they don't just hear that. But when their hearing is heard in the spirit of the emotions of the mind, what is being said to them in their mind runs a movie, so now they can see what the person is saying. Now that right there, I just want to jump inside this piano, which means when I really hear from God, I can see what God just said. And if I can see it, y'all ain't hear me, then I can have it. Y'all ain't hear me. I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. See, I just came to the people that say, I heard from the Lord. You couldn't have heard from the Lord. Because when you hear a word from God, you can see it. That's why people don't understand that when some of y'all hear the word of the Lord, you just jump up and go to run and say, what's he running for? Because I just saw something. What you mean you just saw something? Because my spirit man heard from a different dimension. And what I just heard turned into sight. And now, Lord, I see what you're saying. I ain't hear nobody. Mother. Now, this go all the way back to kindergarten. The first game I remember in kindergarten. I'm 56. I remember this like yesterday. They say, everybody sit down, line up. The teacher going to tell you something over here. And you can only repeat it one time. You pass it down, you tell the person. Uh-huh. Ice cream and cake. Uh-huh. Ice cream and cake. Uh-huh. Ice it and take. I see you bake. Jump in the lake. So by the time you get all the way over here, what the person in authority said, it's gotten lost in translation. I'm not hearing y'all. But how many people can see me right now? What I got on? What I got on? A white and black robe. Say, what I got on? I done moved over here. What I still got on? I'm over here. What I still got on? I'm way over here. What do I still have on? I'm all the way over here. What do I still have on? I'm all the way over here. What do I still have on? What I'm here. What do I have on? Because when you can see it, what I see will not change. I see it. Man of God. Jesus did not contain the power to change his mind about the cross because he was slain before the foundation of the world was laid. He saw it and he wore it. Because he couldn't erase what he saw. Man of God, he heard the people saying, you are king. He heard the people saying, you so wonderful. He heard the people saying, you a miracle worker. But he could not erase what he saw. He saw himself slain before the foundation of the world. To when God said, well, who gonna save the world, he said, prepare me a body and I'll take what I seen and I'll put it in a body.
And I'll take it all the way to the cross. Because I done already seen that I'm supposed to go there. So I couldn't change it. And Dr. Medina said to me one day, a little while back, while I was in the middle of my trial, she said, "You walk around and act like you got a secret." I said, "I do." She said, "You don't seem to be bothered by nothing." I said, "Because I'm not." Because once you see something, see, everybody else is shouting right now. I saw this day coming. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Who am I talking to? See, the reason why I'm just said that to somebody in here, because whatever the Lord done showed you, you better start running in this place. Because when I tell you, he don't show you nothing unless it's already done. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. You might can doubt what he said, but when he show it to you, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. It's as good as done. And what y'all waiting on to do? Y'all waiting to see it in your hand. But if you done saw it in your spirit, it's already in your hand. Somebody better give God a praise up in here. I need somebody to bless it. I can't get nobody to bless it. Somebody bless it. Somebody bless it. I already got it. I already possess it. I've already seen it. Hold on a minute. See, because don't listen. Don't shortchange yourself. Because I'm talking to the people now that's done seen something. Because see, when you done seen something, you don't praise God like everybody else. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. You praise God different because you already got the victory. You praise God different because the work is already done. He showed you the finished product. Somebody better give God a praise in here. Somebody give God a praise in here. Scared to praise him. Y'all scared to praise him. Y'all scared to praise him. Y'all scared to praise him. Because you're afraid to praise him on what you saw. You're afraid to tell anybody what you saw. Because they're going to call you crazy. Who am I preaching to? But it's not a vision from God until you can't explain it. It ain't a real vision from God until people think you crazy. Somebody give God a shout. They said he got up on the third day. Can anybody in here do me the honors of asking me or telling me why? He got up on the third day, Dr. Medina, because before he went to the cross, he saw himself getting up.
I can't get nobody to praise him right there. He even prophesied that thing. He said, if you destroy this body in 3 days, I'm going to rise again. You got to see yourself doing it. Who am I talking to? My God, I'm preaching to somebody. Somebody better start praising God, because if you don't see yourself doing it, you will never do it.
Somebody then said he went to hell and got the keys to death, hell, and the grave. Somebody asked me how he did that.
because he saw himself doing it. Son. 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 Somebody said, and he was transfigured. He went up in the glory cloud. Somebody said, well, how he do that? Because he saw himself come down. And he saw himself going back. He saw himself being born. And I don't care if they did decree that they were going to kill all the young people. He didn't see himself dying at 12. He saw himself dying. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Everything Jesus did, he saw himself doing it. Before he had done anything, the Bible said that when he came up out of the water, God spoke and said, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. And he hadn't done nothing yet. But even God saw him doing it and gave him credit before he even did it. Now, see, y'all, I can't get nobody to go. See, what God's trying to do in here tonight, he's trying to give you credit before you get it. I can't get nobody to talk to me. He just wants you to praise him because he's trying to give you a heads up that it's about to break up. It's about to be downloaded. You're about to get it. But I need you to praise me. I need you to glorify me right now. You got to see yourself happen. Some of y'all standing there, you missing your moment. Some of y'all standing there, you missing your moment. No. No. Let me help you with this one. See, that's why the enemy don't want y'all to give God. I'm not talking about religion now. I'm not talking about because we dancing. I'm not talking about down. The devil don't want you to find your own praise. He don't want you to find your shout without drums. Y'all, because he won't attach your victory to a beat. I'm not giving y'all. But what God is doing in this place right now, he's giving you the kind of praise that you're going to have to leave out the grocery store someday. Yes, you're going to have to pull the car over. Because after tonight, God going to open up heaven. He's going to show you in a vision what he's about to do in your life. Who am I talking to? I said praise him right now. Come on, just praise him. Come on, praise him. Praise him. You got to find your praise. You got to find your shout. You got to find your dance. Hey, God's trying to show you something. Somebody, give him a shout. He's trying to show you something. You better praise him till you see it. 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 God, he's trying to reveal it to you. He's trying to show it to you. God, he's downloading it now. Somebody give him a praise. This is what the devil don't want. This is what the enemy don't want. Hey. prove it to you some more. I got to prove it to you some more. I got to prove it to you some more. I got to prove it to you some more. Abraham. God spoke some things to Abraham. He spoke some things to Abraham. But he couldn't walk in none of it until he said, look out as far as your eyes can see. And I'm going to give it to you. Y'all. You ain't looking for enough. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I said, you ain't looking far enough. Somebody said, well, prophetess, I can't hardly see. Praise become your windshield wipers in a storm. I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. That's why in the next 30 seconds, you better start praising God. Because he get me to clear your windshield so you can see what he get me to do. Somebody get him a praise. Somebody give him a praise. Somebody praise him. Somebody praise.